Hello everyone, today we will talk about bronchiectasis. Before we proceed with the video, I have put some questions in the comment section. Do look at these questions and answer as comments. So proceeding to our video on bronchiectasis, what is bronchiectasis? It is irreversible or permanent airway dilation. So this is an airway dilation which cannot be reversed. Once it happens, it will be there. Now, why does it happen? That is because of destruction of smooth muscle and supporting elastic tissue. So here this schematic diagram is showing that suppose this is the normal airways and this we are seeing the dilated airways. And here it is showing a diagram where you see bronchioles have become so dilated that they are coming near to the pleural surface also. In fact, in pathology, they can be seen, some of the bronchus can be seen at the level of the pleural surface. Now, why this bronchiectasis happens? What is the pathophysiology? So, this is a vicious feedback cycle between the impaired mucociliary clearance. That means the mucus remains in the bronchioles and the bronchus and it is not cleared from there. This creates an obstruction in the bronchus. And because of the obstruction, there are high chances of infection, and infection does happen, leading to chronic inflammation. So infection, and because of this infection, again, there is impaired mucociliary clearance. So this is a vicious cycle with impaired mucociliary clearance, obstruction and infection. Now, important thing to understand here is that the cycle can start anywhere. Either it can be due to infection, which leads to impaired mucociliary clearance, or it can be due to obstruction, which leads to impaired mucociliary clearance and the infection, or the primary cause can be impaired mucociliary clearance itself. So wherever it starts, this proceeds as a vicious cycle. So let us see what can be the causes with each of these as primary cause. First is impaired mucociliary clearance. Primary cause can be cystic fibrosis and primary ciliary dyskinesia, also known as immotile cilia syndrome or cartilaginous syndrome. Primary ciliary dyskinesia, cilia are not working properly, so they will not be able to clear the mucus. Okay, see, there are goblet cells are there, mucus glands are there, which are continuously secreting mucus. Our cilia work in this direction, moving the mucus up towards the mouth and ultimately it is ingested. But if this cilia is not working, then that mucus clearance is not going to take place, leading to the mucus impaction. What is cystic fibrosis? In cystic fibrosis, there are certain channels known as chloride channels, which are CFTR channels. Cystic fibrosis transmembrane receptors. And when chloride is released into the mucus by these channels, it causes the movement of water also. Now, when chloride secretion decreases because of the mutation in the gene whose product is the CFTR channel, chloride secretion is not going to take place. If chloride doesn't enter into the mucus, then water is also not going to enter into the mucus, and that is going to decrease the watery content of the mucus. So mucus will become very thick and viscid. And this cilia, even if working, they will not be able to move that thick and viscid mucus up. Okay, so that is impaired mucociliary clearance. Second one is obstruction. If obstruction is the primary cause, then generally this bronchiectasis is limited to a local area. See, here we have talked impaired mucociliary clearance when it is the cause. It leads to diffuse involvement in many lobes of the lung. In this obstruction, when there is local obstruction, then in that particular area only there will be bronchiectasis development. Okay, so we have extrinsic obstruction or intrinsic obstruction. So here this diagram is showing extrinsic obstruction. This is the airways, and here some extrinsic obstruction has obstructed the airways. So whatever mucus is there, that is not being cleared from the area. So this leads to obstruction, infection, and ultimately because of the inflammation, there is destruction of the smooth muscle and elastic tissue, leading to airway dilation. Okay, so what can be the causes? Extrinsic obstruction can be due to lymphadenopathy, can be due to tumor mass which is developing and compressing the airways. Then intrinsic obstruction can also be there, if there is airway tumor, if there is an aspirated foreign body, or airways are scarred. Then moving on to the third cause, that if the primary cause is infection. So this infection can be either respiratory infection, repeated respiratory infection are occurring, that is H influenza and Pseudomonas aeruginosa, that can be the cause, especially in children. We look for these causes. Then there can be systemic causes also which are leading to either respiratory infection or they are leading to destruction of the airways. Okay. So for example, if there is immunodeficiency, then it will lead to repeated infection. Then HIV, it's an immunodeficient state, it will also lead to repeated infection. Then there can be causes of autoimmune disorders in which antibodies are produced and that leads to destruction of the airway. Then there can be some neuromuscular disorders also, because these neuromuscular disorders, they will lead to the weakening of the esophagus. Okay, so the lower esophageal sphincter will not be that much tight. So this will lead to repeated aspirations into the respiratory tract, thus leading to infection, inflammation, and finally impaired mucociliary clearance and obstruction. So that ultimately will cause bronchiectasis. Okay, so just remember this pathophysiology chart: impaired mucociliary clearance, obstruction and infection, and the primary cause can be anything. See, bronchiectasis is not a primary disorder. It occurs due to some other causes. So whenever bronchiectasis is diagnosed, we have to look for that due to which cause this bronchiectasis is occurring, so that we can treat that particular cause and also prevent repeated infections. Okay. Now, depending on the cause, we have different areas of the lungs which are involved. For example, central airways are commonly involved in allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis. It is an allergic condition, allergic response to aspergillosis. So in this case, central airways are involved, or there can be congenital cause of cartilage deficiency. Then upper lung fields are involved generally in cystic fibrosis. There is diffuse involvement, but we see more involvement of upper lung fields. Then post radiation fibrosis. So if this region, if there is radiation is given, then there can be post radiation fibrosis. Then middle lung fields, that can be due to NTM, that is non-tuberculous mycobacteria, or immotile cilia syndrome. And lower lung fields are involved in chronic recurrent aspiration, which I told you that is also a cause of bronchiectasis, and immunodeficiency associated infections. So by seeing the x-ray and by seeing the CT scan, if we determine that, okay, what is the site of the lung which is involved, that also will give us one idea that what can be the cause of this bronchiectasis, and the investigations hence will follow accordingly. Now, what can be the complications of this? First of all, that because the airway is dilated and there is a blockage of the airways, actually this is an obstructive disorder. Okay, so basically the air is not being exhaled out properly and this leads to hyperinflation. Okay, now whenever there is hyperinflation, basically the ventilation is decreased, the amount of air which can go in and go out, that is decreased, because we are operating at a more inflated level. So this leads to decrease in ventilation, hence decrease in the partial pressure of oxygen in blood, that is hypoxia, and also increase in the partial pressure of carbon dioxide in the blood, that is hypercarbia. Okay, so basically it will lead to respiratory failure in long term, causing hypoxia and hypercarbia due to decrease in ventilation. And if there is decrease in ventilation, then obviously it will cause ventilation perfusion mismatch. Then, because the person is getting repeated infections and we might be giving them antibiotics again and again, so this can lead to resistance to antibiotics. Then in this sense, I told you that there is destruction of the walls of the airways. So along those airways, we have blood vessels also which are running. Okay, so here there are blood vessels. So if these walls are destroyed, the walls of the vessels may also be destroyed, and hence the blood will enter into the airways. This blood is coughed up, which is basically hemoptysis. So hemoptysis is a sign of destruction of the vessels, right? And sometimes this hemoptysis can be life-threatening. When major vessels are affected, then this hemoptysis can be life-threatening and it will require treatment. It will require bronchial artery embolization. Okay. Then long-standing, because of the hypoxia, it can lead to pulmonary hypertension, because the pulmonary vessels are going to vasoconstrict and this leads to pulmonary hypertension. Ultimately, pulmonary hypertension will lead to right heart failure. So with this background, let us see what will be the clinical features in bronchiectasis. So what is the main cause? Main cause, I told you, decreased bronchoceleric clearance is there, obstruction and infections. Okay, so this decreased bronchoceleric clearance leads to persistent cough with copious purulent sputum. Excessive sputum is there, which sometimes is foul smelling as well. Okay. So whenever there is persistent cough with copious lot of amount of sputum and which is foul smelling, we should suspect bronchiectasis. On examination, what we will see? On examination, general examination, we will see clubbing is usually present in bronchiectasis. And if it is a late disease, we will see signs of respiratory failure. Respiratory rate will increase, dyspnea will be present, use of accessory muscles of respiration will be there. Signs of right heart failure may also be present. That is, we will see rise in the JVP, elevated JVP we will see, peripheral edema can be seen. Then, on inspection, palpation, percussion, we will see signs of hyperinflation. Okay, because there is blockage, it's an obstructive lung disorder. So we will see signs of hyperinflation. All these signs of hyperinflation I have already dealt in the video on chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Do watch that video where in detail I have told that what we will see in inspection, palpation, percussion with signs of hyperinflation. Very important, there will be obliteration of the cardiac dullness. Apical impulse will not be seen, neither it will be felt. Then auscultation, since it's an airway disorder where blockage is there, we will hear crackles, and if pulmonary hypertension has developed, then there will be splitting of S2. Now what will be the investigations which we have to do? First is, obviously, in any pulmonary disorder, we have to assess the functional status of the person. So we have to do pulmonary function test. We have to perform spirometry. Since it is an obstructive disorder, we will have decreased FEV1-FVC ratio, that is the obstructive pattern. Then when we get a chest x-ray, we will see dilated airways, which is seen as tram track pattern. Okay, so these airways will be visible extending towards the pleural surface. Normally till the pleural surface we are not seeing the airway, so that will be extending towards the pleural surface. Because of the dilation they are visible. But most specific investigation is high resolution CT, where we will see this tram track pattern and signet ring sign will be seen. So here this is shown a signet ring, and here CT is shown, where we see here, see, this is signet ring. Okay, these are signet ring which are seen. Okay, let me magnify it. See, this is the signet ring which is seen. So this is the classical signet ring pattern seen in bronchiectasis. And why we see? Because there is dilatation of the airways, so the cross-sectional area of the airways is much more. It becomes 1.5 times diameter than that of the adjacent vessel. So this basically, the small dot which we are seeing in signet ring, that is the adjacent vessel, and nearby we are seeing these dilated airways. Fine. Then we see tubular structures within 1 centimeter from pleural surface. Okay. So once this bronchiectasis is diagnosed, we are sure that this is bronchiectasis. We have to do the workup for finding out what is the cause of bronchiectasis. Okay. So if it is focal bronchiectasis, we have seen that obstruction is the cause for focal bronchiectasis. So we have to investigate for that causes. And for that, bronchoscopy is must, okay, to look for the presence of obstruction. Then we have to look for any immunodeficiency, that is, we have to look for the levels of IgA, we have to investigate for HIV, we have to check for the presence of infection, which organism is involved, so we have to do Gram staining, then for the acid fast bacillus, because post-tubercular also bronchiectasis can develop, okay. Then we have to check for the presence of any neuromuscular disorder which is causing repeated aspirations. Okay. Now, what will be the treatment? So, if we know the pathophysiology, we have to direct our treatment towards that, right? So, we have told that mucociliary clearance, obstruction and infection. So, we have to ensure proper mucociliary clearance. So, hydration works for that. There are many techniques which promote mucociliary clearance. One is the postural drainage. Okay, that is the technique in which the person is made to lie in a position which promotes this mucociliary clearance. Then we have to give mucolytics. Then nebulization with bronchodilator, so that promotes the mucociliary clearance by dilating the airways, obviously, which are not permanently dilated. So that helps in clearing the passages. Then there is chest physiotherapy, in which the person is wearing such kind of vest and there is vibration of the chest which promotes this mucus clearance from the chest. Then there are traditional therapies also in which cupping of the hand is used to percuss on the chest, and that also promotes mucus clearance. Then second thing is control of the infection and inflammation. We have to treat the cause, treat the infection. Sometimes if the person is getting repeated infections, then suppressive antibiotics are also used. Okay. But this suppressive antibiotics, we have to weigh the risk and the benefits, because if these suppressive antibiotics are used for long term, then it may also cause resistance to the antibiotics. Okay. So if the person really needs this, if he is getting repeated recurrent infection, then sometimes this suppressive antibiotics can be given, and there are various protocols by which it can be given. Then vaccination against H influenza and pneumococcal vaccine has to be given. Maintenance of bronchial hygiene, that is by mucus clearance, also prevents recurrent infection. If there is any obstruction, we have to remove that obstruction. And sometimes the person has life-threatening hemoptysis. In that case, bronchial artery embolization is also required. This is not a part of inflammation control. This is like separate treatment. Then in advanced cases, sometimes surgery may be required. There are two options. One is resection of focal areas can be done. If there is focal bronchiectasis and it is leading to recurrent infection, which is refractory to treatment. Second is, if there is diffuse involvement, then lung transplantation can be done. So that was all about bronchiectasis. As I have told you before, that I have put some questions in the comment section. Do comment your answers and let me know how you find this video. Thanks for watching the video. If you liked it, do press the like button, share the video with others, and do subscribe to the channel Physiology Open. Thank you.